गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम टू अर्थ रन। एज वी ऑल नो, द जर्नी ऑफ 1,000 miles बिगेंस विद अ सिंगल स्टेप। होप सो दैट यू ऑल हैड स्टार्टेड योर जर्नी टू क्रैक द UPSC एग्जामिनेशन, बट इफ नॉट देन यू कांट गो बैक एंड चेंज द बिगनिंग, बट यू कैन स्टार्ट वेयर यू आर एंड चेंज द एंडिंग। एज वी ऑल नो, फॉर क्लियरिंग एनी एग्जामिनेशन द टू बेसिक पिलर्स आर सिलेबस एंड प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस। So here in this video, we will discuss the part 1 of UPSC prelims 2021 paper, that is the first 25 questions of UPSC prelims 2021 paper.
Let's begin with our first question, that is, under the Indian Constitution, concentration of wealth violates. This is a direct question from Constitution. Article 39C of Indian Constitution talks about prevention of concentration of wealth, which is under part 4 of Indian Constitution. That is, it violates DPSP, Directive Principles of State Policy. So, the correct option for this question is option B, the Directive Principles of State Policy. Part 4 of Indian Constitution, that is DPSP, contains Article 36 to Article 51. Moving to question number 2, what is the position of the right to property in India? So here is another question from Polity and Constitution. Here I would like to tell you all one thing, that this time there were a total of 18 questions from Polity, which is quite a huge number. Let's get back to the question. Earlier, right to property was a fundamental right, but by 44th constitutional amendment, it was omitted from the list of fundamental rights and it was made a legal right under Article 300A of our Constitution. So this article guarantees right to property to all persons. Hence, answer will be option B, legal right applicable to any person. Moving to third question, what was the exact constitutional status of India on 26 January 1950? So again a direct question. As we all know, secular and socialist were originally not present in our preamble. They were added by 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act 1976. 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act, which is also known as mini constitution. So on 26 January 1950, India was sovereign democratic republic. Hence option B is correct, a sovereign democratic republic. Moving to question 4, constitutional government means. Again, a straightforward question. For this question, we can simply evaluate these four options and we can reach to a logical conclusion. A representative government of a nation with federal structure. A government whose head enjoys nominal powers. A government whose head enjoys real powers. A government limited by the terms of the constitution. So, constitutional government means a government limited by the terms of the constitution. Other than this option, the all other options are not of much relevance. So the correct option for this question is option D, a government limited by the terms of the constitution. Moving to fifth question, with reference to India, the terms Halbi, Ho and Q pertain to. So the correct option for this question is tribal languages, as Halbi, Ho and Q are tribal languages. Halbi is an Eastern Indo-Aryan language, transitional between Odia and Marathi. Ho is a Munda language of the Austroasiatic language family, is spoken primarily in India by about 1.04 million people as per the 2001 census. Q is a Southeastern Dravidian language spoken by the Kandhas. It is mostly spoken in Odisha and written in Odia script. Now, question 6. Consider the following statements in respect of Bharat Ratna and Padma Awards. Bharat Ratna and Padma Awards are titles under the Article 18(1) of the Constitution of India. Padma Awards, which were instituted in the year 1954, were suspended only once. The number of Bharat Ratna Awards is restricted to a maximum of 5 in a particular year. So, Statement 1 is incorrect, as national awards such as Bharat Ratna, Padma Vibhushan, Padma Bhushan and Padma Shri do not amount to titles within the meaning of Article 18(1) of the Constitution, and thus are not to be used as prefixes or suffixes to the name of the recipient in any manner. Article 18(1) abolishes all titles. It prohibits the state to confer titles on anybody, whether a citizen or a non-citizen. So, statement 1 is incorrect. Now, statement 2. Statement 2 is also incorrect, as Padma Awards were instituted in 1954, but the government suspended the practice of granting the Padma Awards for 2 years in 1977, and it was again suspended during mid-1992. So, statement 2 is also incorrect. And statement 3 is also incorrect, as a maximum of 3 people can be awarded the Bharat Ratna. So which of the above statements are not correct? The correct option for this question is option D, as all the 3 statements are not correct. Moving to question number 7. This question is from current affairs and is related to the organizations. This time there were a total of 5 questions from current affairs, and in which 3 were from sports and 2 questions were related from organizations. So let's get back to the question. Consider the following statements. Statement 1. The United Nations Capital Development Fund, UNCDF, and the Arbor Day Foundation have recently recognized Hyderabad as 2020 Tree City of the World. Statement 2. Hyderabad was selected for the recognition for a year following its commitment to grow and maintain the urban forest. Which of the following is correct in respect of the above statements? So, statement 1. In this statement, UNCDF is not at all related to the Hyderabad 2020 Tree City of the World. Yes, it is true that Hyderabad is recognized as 2020 Tree City of the World, but it was recognized this by the Arbor Day Foundation and Food and Agriculture Organization. So there will be Food and Agriculture Organization in place of UNCDF. So this statement is incorrect. And now moving to statement 2. Statement 2 is correct, as Hyderabad was selected for the recognition for a year following its commitment to grow and maintain the urban forest. So clearly in this statement 1 is not correct and statement 2 is correct. So our correct option is option D. Statement 1 is not correct, but statement 2 is correct. Moving to question number 8. Consider the following statements in respect of the Laureus World Sports Award, which was instituted in the year 2000. American golfer Tiger Woods was the first winner of this award. The award was received mostly by Formula One players so far. Roger Federer received this award maximum number of times compared to others. Which of the above statements are correct? So, statement 1 is correct, as American golfer Tiger Woods was the first winner of this award. Statement 2 is not correct, as this award was received mostly by tennis players, not by Formula 1 players. Statement 3 is also correct, as Roger Federer received this award maximum number of times compared to others. After him, there is Novak Djokovic, who received it maximum times, and after him, Rafael Nadal. And Roger Federer is a Swiss tennis player. Novak Djokovic is also a tennis player, Serbian tennis player. And Rafael Nadal is also a tennis player, Spanish tennis player. So in this, the statement 1st and 3rd are correct. And statement 2 is not correct. So the correct option for this is 1 and 3 only. That is option C. Moving to question number 9. Again, a question from Sports Current Affairs. Consider the following statements in respect of the 32nd Summer Olympics. The official motto for this Olympics is A New World. Sport climbing, surfing, skateboarding, karate, and baseball are included in this Olympics. Which of the above statements are correct? So, let's see statement 1. The 32nd Summer Olympics was held in Tokyo in 2021. The Tokyo 2020 official games motto was United by Emotion. So statement 1 is incorrect. And A New World, it was the official slogan for Rio Olympics 2016. Now statement 2. The Tokyo Olympics has 339 events across 41 different sports. and 6 new sports will be contested at the Tokyo Olympics, that are baseball, softball, karate, skateboarding, sport climbing and surfing. So statement 2 is correct. Therefore, our correct option is option B, that is 2 only. Now, question 10, which is again from sports current affairs. Consider the following statements in respect of the ICC World Test Championship. Statement 1, the finalists were decided by the number of matches they won. Statement 2, New Zealand was ranked ahead of England because it won more matches than England. Which of the above statements are correct? So in this, the correct option is option D, neither 1 nor 2, as both the statements are incorrect. Statement 1 is incorrect because the finalists of the ICC World Test Championship are to be decided by percentage of points earned, not by number of matches won by them. And statement 2 is incorrect as New Zealand won less matches than England but won more points, thus entering the final. Moving to question 11, which is related to the Right to the City. Right to the City was seen in news in the context of Delhi's draft master plan 2041. Consider the following statements. Right to the City is an agreed human right and the UN Habitat monitors the commitments made by each country in this regard. Second, Right to the City gives every occupant of the city the right to reclaim public spaces and public participation in the city. Third, Right to the City means that the state cannot deny any public service or facility to the unauthorized colonies in the city. Which of the statements given above are correct? So in this, option C is correct, which implies that statement 1 and 2 are correct. Right to the City is a holistic approach to improving the quality of everyday life in cities. Statement 1 is correct as the Right to the City is at the heart of the new urban agenda agreed at Habitat 3rd. UN Habitat partners with national and local governments, academia, civil society and the private sector in implementation and monitoring of the commitment made under the new urban agenda and SDG 11. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights commits to social justice through the promotion, defense, and fulfillment of all human rights related to habitat, including the human right to adequate housing, land, and the right to the city in every region of the world. There is also a World Charter for the Right to the City, which provides a progressive framework to rethink cities and urbanization. Statement 2 is correct, as the Right to the City is the right of all inhabitants to inhabit, use, occupy, produce, transform, govern, and enjoy cities, towns, and human settlements that are just, inclusive, safe, sustainable, and democratic, defined as common goods for enjoying life with dignity and peace. The Right to the City further implies responsibilities on governments and people to claim, defend, and promote this right. This right claims for the social function of the city, quality public spaces, sustainable and inclusive rural-urban linkages, inclusive economies, inclusive citizenship, enhanced political participation, non-discrimination, gender equality, and cultural diversity. Now, moving to statement 3. Statement 3 is incorrect as the right to the city does not mean the guarantee of any public service or facility to the unauthorized colonies in a city. It guarantees the common goods and services which are essential for the quality of life. Moving to question 12. With reference to India, consider the following statements. Statement 1. Judicial custody means an accused is in the custody of the concerned magistrate and such accused is locked up in police station, not in jail. Statement 2. During judicial custody, the police officer in charge of the case is not allowed to interrogate the suspect without the approval of the court. Which of the statements given above are correct? So the correct option for this question is option B, 2 only. See, there are two terms, police custody and judicial custody, and Article 22 talks about procedure for arrest and kept in detention. Person in arrest should be presented before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours and then he will authenticate the cause of arrest or cause of detention. So statement one is incorrect, as in judicial custody, accused is locked up in jail, not in police station. And if he is locked up in police station, then it is a police custody, not a judicial custody. And statement two is correct, as in judicial custody, the investigation officer cannot investigate unless or until permitted by the court. Now, question 13. With reference to India, consider the following statements. Statement 1. When a prisoner makes out a sufficient case, parole cannot be denied to such a prisoner because it becomes a matter of his/her right. Statement 2. State governments have their own prisoners release on parole rules. Which of the statements given above is or correct? So the correct option for this question is option B, that is 2 only. Statement 1 is incorrect, as parole is a system of releasing a prisoner with suspension of the sentence. Parole cannot be claimed as a matter of right. Parole may be denied to a prisoner even when he makes out sufficient cause for release on parole. Parole is to be granted only on a sufficient cause, such as cases of severe illness or death of any family member of the prisoner. The granting authority for parole is the Deputy Home Secretary of the state government. But parole can be denied if the competent authority is of the opinion that releasing the inmate would not be in the interest of the society. Statement 2 is correct, as state governments have their own prisoner release on parole rules. Prisons is a state subject under the state list of the 7th schedule of the Constitution. The management and administration of prisons fall exclusively in the domain of state governments and are governed by the Prisons Act 1894 and the prison manuals of the respective state governments. The Prisons Act further says that only states can make rules regarding the release of prisoners on parole and remission as part of the correctional process in jail reforms. Moving to question number 14. At the national level, which ministry is the nodal agency to ensure effective implementation of the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act 2006? So again, a straightforward factual question from an important law which recognizes the rights of tribals, that is Scheduled Caste and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Act 2006. So the manage and implementing nodal ministry for this law is Ministry of Tribal Affairs. That is option D is the correct option for this question. Moving to question 15, a legislation which confers on the executive or administrative authority an unguided and uncontrolled discretionary power in the matter of application of law violates which of the following articles of the Constitution of India? Option A, Article 14, Option B, Article 28, Option C, Article 32, Option D, Article 44. So in this question, the unguided and uncontrolled discretionary power of the executive or administrative authority has been talked about. Article 44, which is related to the Uniform Civil Code, is not at all related to this question. Article 32 has also no connection with this question, as it talks about writs. Article 28 talks about religious freedom, so this is also not related to this question. So our correct option is option A, Article 14, as B, C, D have no connection with this question. So the correct answer is option A, Article 14, which is related to equality before law and equal protection of law. Now question 16. Which one of the following in Indian polity is an essential feature that indicates that it is federal in character? Option A, the independence of judiciary is safeguarded. Option B, the union legislature has elected representatives from constituent units. Option C, the union cabinet can have elected representatives from regional parties. Option D, the fundamental rights are enforceable by courts of law. So the correct option for this is option A, that is the independence of judiciary is safeguarded. The establishment of an independent judiciary necessarily indicates the federal character of Indian polity. The constitution establishes an independent judiciary headed by the Supreme Court to settle the disputes between the center and the states or between the states. Now let us see some of the federal features of Indian Constitution, that are dual polity consisting of the union at the center and the states at the periphery, written constitution, division of powers between the center and the states by Schedule 7, supremacy of the constitution, rigidity of the constitution, bicameral legislature consisting of Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, independency of judiciary. Moving to question 17, which is related to the term state. Which one of the following best defines the term state? Option A, a committee of persons permanently occupying a definite territory independent of external control and processing an organized government. Option B, a politically organized people of a definite territory and possessing an authority to govern them, maintain law and order, protect their natural rights, and safeguard their means of sustenance. Option C, a number of persons who have been living in a definite territory for a very long time with their own culture, tradition, and government. Option D, a society permanently living in a definite territory with a central authority, an executive responsible to the central authority, and an independent judiciary. So in this, the correct option is option A. A state is a community of persons permanently occupying a definite portion of territory independent of external control and possessing an organized government. According to Max Weber, a state is a human community that claims the monopoly of the legitimate use of physical force within a given territory. The state possesses a government which has the authority to enforce a system of rules over the people living inside it. That system of rules is commonly composed of a constitution, statutes, regulations, and common law. Its main functions can be maintaining law, order, and stability, resolving various kinds of disputes through the legal system, providing common defense, and looking out for the welfare of the population in ways that are beyond the mean of the individual, such as implementing public health measures, providing mass education, and underwriting expensive medical research. Now, question 18. With reference to Indian judiciary, consider the following statements. Statement 1. Any retired judge of the Supreme Court of India can be called back to sit and act as a Supreme Court judge by the Chief Justice of India with prior permission of the President of India. Statement 2. A High Court in India has the power to review its own judgment as the Supreme Court does. Which of the statements given above is are correct? So the correct option for this question is option C, that is both 1 and 2, which implies that both the statements are correct. Statement 1 is correct. The Chief Justice of India can request a retired judge of the Supreme Court or a retired judge of a High Court to act as a judge of the Supreme Court for a temporary period. He can do so only with the previous consent of the President and also of the person to be so appointed. Such a judge is entitled to such allowances as the President may determine. He will also enjoy all the jurisdiction, powers, and privileges of a judge of Supreme Court. Statement 2 is also correct. The Supreme Court of India has power to review its own judgment or order. Thus, it is not bound by its previous decision and can depart from it in the interest of justice or community welfare. As a court of record, a high court also has the power to review and correct its own judgment or order. Now, question 19. With reference to India, consider the following statements. There is only one citizenship and one domicile. A citizen by birth only can become the head of a state. A foreigner was granted the citizenship cannot be deprived of it under any circumstances. Which of the statements given above is are correct? The correct option for this question is option A, one only, which implies that only first statement is correct. The Indian Constitution provides for only a single citizenship, that is the Indian citizenship. The citizens in India owe allegiance only to the Union. There is no separate state citizenship. Also, when an Indian citizen voluntarily acquires the citizenship of another country, his Indian citizenship automatically terminates. Statement 2 is incorrect. The president is the head of the Indian state. In India, both a citizen by birth as well as a naturalized citizen are eligible for the office of president. Thus, a naturalized citizen can become the head of the state in India. Statement 3 is incorrect. A foreigner who has been earlier granted Indian citizenship can be deprived of his citizenship. His Indian citizenship can be terminated by the central government if he has obtained the citizenship by fraud, he has shown disloyalty to the Constitution of India, he has unlawfully traded or communicated with the enemy during a war, he has within 5 years after registration or naturalization been imprisoned in any country for 2 years, and he has been ordinarily resident out of India for 7 years continuously. Now, question 20. Which one of the following factors constitutes the best safeguard of liberty in a liberal democracy? So in this, the correct option is option D, separation of powers. The separation of powers between the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary constitute an important safeguard of liberty in a liberal democracy. The doctrine of separation of powers entails the division of the legislative, executive, and judicial functions of government among different organs. This separation minimizes the possibility of arbitrary excesses by the government, since all the three organs act as check and balance on the powers of each other. Therefore, none of the three organs can usurp the essential functions of other organs. This demarcation prevents the concentration of excessive power by any branch of the government. It thus helps to safeguard the liberty and rights of the people in a democracy. Moving to question number 21. Water can dissolve more substances than any other liquid because. So the correct option for this question is option A, that is, it is dipolar in nature. Water is called the universal solvent because it is capable of dissolving more substances than any other liquid. It is water's chemical composition and physical attributes that make it such an excellent solvent. Water molecules have a polar arrangement of oxygen and hydrogen atoms. One side hydrogen has a positive electrical charge and the other side oxygen had a negative charge. This allows the water molecule to become attracted to many other different types of molecules. So in this, option A is the correct option. Now, question 22. With reference to street lighting, how do sodium lamps differ from LED lamps? First, sodium lamps produce light in 360 degrees, but it is not so in the case of LED lamps. Second, as street lights, sodium lamps have longer lifespan than LED lamps. Third, the spectrum of visible light from sodium lamp is almost monochromatic, while LED lamps offer significant color advantages in street lighting. Select the correct answer using the quotes given below. So the correct answer for this question is option C, that is 1 and 3, which implies that only first and third statement are correct. Statement 1 is correct. Sodium lamps produce light in 360 degrees, but it is not so in the case of LED lamps. LED lamps have 180 degree bulb angle to preserve light efficiency and allow for target lighting over areas. Statement 2 is incorrect. As street lights, sodium lamps have on an average shorter lifespan than LED lamps. High pressure sodium lamps tend to have a lifespan averaging 24,000 hours, whereas LED lamps' lifespan ranges from 25,000 to 2 lakh hours. Statement 3 is correct. The spectrum of visible light from sodium lamp is almost monochromatic, as they are known for their warm yellow glow. On the other hand, LED lamps offer significant color advantages in street lighting. LEDs offer variety of color options, providing better lighting solutions than high-pressure sodium counterpart. Moving to question 23rd, the term ACE2 is talked about in the context of. The correct option for this question is option D, that is, spread of viral diseases. ACE2, angiotensin converting enzyme 2 is a protein on the surface of many cell types. It is an enzyme that generates small proteins by cutting up the larger protein angiotensinogen that then go on to regulate functions in the cell. ACE2 acts as a cellular doorway, a receptor for the virus that causes COVID-19. In the search for treatments for COVID-19, many researchers are focusing their attention on a specific protein that allows the virus to infect human cells. Now, question 24. Bisphenol A, BPA, a cause of concern, is a structural / key component in the manufacture of which of the following kinds of plastics? So the correct option for this question is option B, that is polycarbonate. Bisphenol A is a chemical used to make polycarbonate plastic. Polycarbonate plastic is used to make hard plastic items such as baby bottles, reusable water bottles, food containers, pitchers, tableware, and other storage containers. Now, question 25. Triclosan, considered harmful when exposed to high levels for a long time, is most likely present in which of the following? So the correct option for this is option D, that is toiletries. Triclosan is an ingredient added to many consumer products intended to reduce or prevent bacterial contamination. It is added to some antibacterial soaps and body washes, toothpaste, and some cosmetics. Thank you for watching this video and supporting our initiative.